Michigan basketball today. 8:12 noon tip-off from the Chrysler Center, also an AM 950. It's a good one. Number 5, Michigan entertaining number 10, Oregon. Downtown Detroit at the LCA, 12 noon the tip-off. Number 16, MSU taking on Oakland University. It's the final day of the President's Cup down in Australia. The Internationals, who've only won this competition once since its debut, they lead the Americans 10-8 with 12 singles matches on tap for the day. Austin Romine, and the former Yankee, is now a Tiger catcher. The 31-year-old and the Tigers finalize a $4.15 million one-year deal. Yes, he's the same guy who got into the brawl with a guy named Cabrera at home plate 2 years ago. That didn't go well for him. Michigan wide receiver Tariq Black entering the transfer portal. He caught 25 balls for 323 yards and a score this season. At the Ticket Update Desk, I'm Jeff Lesson. For more, 97.1theticket.com.
The following is a paid program. The views expressed on this program are not necessarily those of Entercom Communications, its sponsors, or affiliates.
Good morning. Welcome to the Hardcore Mortgage Real Estate Business Show, brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funny. I'm your host, Harvey Freed. Alongside of me, Harry Glanz.
Morning, Harv. How are you today?
I'm fantastic, Harry. And of course, we bring up from our office top producer, of course, Becky Alley.
Hey, good morning, everybody.
Hey, Beck. What's going on?
Hi, Beck.
Man. We got some top-notch people in the
office. You want to introduce everybody? Go ahead. Yeah, you get to do the introductions.
So we have Rebecca and Brian Janowak, and if you're tuning in on Facebook Live, you can see that we have some We Are the World kind of 80s things going on.
They're going to sing it.
Yeah,
Let's go.
We got a party in here, so we got the duo in here, and then we're also joined by Justin Bankston of Fidelity National Title.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
All righty. Great to have all you guys in here. December 14, 2019. Boy, we're running out of days in 2019. There's still time to get your approval letter, and maybe we could actually close a deal in another 15 or 60 days, or 16 days, right, Beck?
We're actually turning transactions extremely fast right now.
All right. That'll be good. So
15 days.
Yeah, get them in, get them out.
Yep.
That's it. Just get them in and get them out. Just worry about what you got to worry about. And the market's hot, guys. I don't know about you. The market's still hot. It's really late in the year to see what's going on in the market. And purchase transactions are still very, very strong. Next week, though, we're going to have an appraiser on. And he's going to tell us about home values, because home values in certain areas, you know, they're starting to level off a little bit. I don't know what you guys are seeing in your area. Absolutely. But we're still seeing a lot of purchase transactions. I know a lot of realtors that are having showings today and tomorrow, and the traffic in these houses is really good, because there seems to be, and you know, we're going to go back to the old saying, which we always do, there seems to be a lack of very strong homes on the market, a lack of quality homes that are listed. You know, what are you guys seeing out there?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, right now you'd say the inventory is somewhat lower in general, which means obviously it's a seller's market. You know, the homes in general, you're having a lot that are kind of, for lack of better terms, kind of less desirable, if you will, the main roads and things like that hitting the market. So like you just, you know, said, those quote-unquote quality homes.
Right.
Absolutely. We're looking for more of those to get and going. And, you know, the market is still hot. You know, every year all the time, oh, there's going to be this or that and with the economy, but no.
Well, it also has to do with the time of year here in Michigan, right, with the weather. The cold, the snow, nobody wants any people traipsing through their house. You know, we see that all the time. We have to let people know out there, look, that's where we live. But I'm going to tell you, people are serious. If people are walking through your home and people have a home listed, it's a serious time. And, you know, the holidays, you know, some people still want to, you know, get that house under contract before the holidays.
Yeah.
They want to have their last Christmas in the house, move out after the new year. So it's still a very good time to buy a home. And every realtor will tell you, hey, guess what? There's less competition out there, too.
Yeah.
Well, you know, that's a great point. And that's one big misconception for Michigan is, oh, it's the middle of the year, because the school year is a big factor. And yes, if you do have kids in school, that could factor in. But like you said, the one big key thing is that homes are still selling. If you have a quality home that is priced right and marketed properly, it is going to sell. And honestly, the buyers that are coming through, because of the weather, they're taking themselves out in the snow and everything else, they are much more serious.
Well, and I'll throw it back to Harvey and Becky. It goes like this. Rates are still really low.
Yes.
Okay, how long are they going to stay low? Nobody knows. You got to lock in that rate.
To the end of time.
We can hope, right?
And they're going down to zero. Everybody thinks that, right? Tell me about that.
I mean, 2016 was the lowest of the low in the history of all of the histories of US of A for the rates. And you either took advantage of that when you could or you couldn't. And during that time, you'd be talking to people, And they would say, oh, I don't know. They're going to go lower. They're going to lower. And, you know, when you're at 2.5 on a 15-year fix, I'm like, I don't know, bro. I don't think it's going to go much lower than that. And, you know, unfortunately, some people thought it was going to go lower and it didn't. And they're calling me and now they're at 3.5 on a 15-year fix. I mean, either way, it's still a great rate. It sounds better, yes. But right now, I would say this would be the second time where they've been the lowest they've been. And to also piggyback what Brian was saying as far as, you know, when they're priced right, I will say this about Brian and Rebecca is when they are meeting with their sellers, okay, they walk them through the transaction, they let them know what's going on, but most importantly, they have that hard conversation up front of, do you want to sell this property? Because a lot of it has to do with it's priced right. Everyone thinks their house is worth $1 million, right?
Oh, yeah.
And they're in Rochester, they're downtown walkable. I mean, it's a great community to be a part of, but they also go all over the place. But they're not afraid to have those hard conversations, say, look, you know, this is where the market is telling us that your house needs to be priced at. And sure, could we put your house at 525? But when it's sitting there for 60 days and you're looking at me like, why hasn't it sold? That's when they step in and say, look, it really should be at 475. And now the market is now reconfirming what I was trying to tell you up front.
So, well, it's setting the proper expectations in anything. So when you set the proper expectations and you go over everything, it's the same way in a mortgage transaction. I can't tell you how many times Harvey and Becky will come into my office and they'll say, listen, we have this buyer and they want X, Y, and Z. And I'll say, well, wait a minute. What's their credit score? What's the loan to value? How long have they been on the job? What's their income? So then when we unfold, it's like an onion. You peel back all the layers. You make sure you check everything out. And that's what we were talking about outside. You have to have somebody that's going to go over every part of the transaction. In real estate, it's the same way.
Absolutely.
You see it in your end of the business. We're all on the same team here. We're all in the same business. You're on one end. We're on the other. And my man over there is in the middle. He brings that. It's a party when we get to him, right?
Justin, we're going to bring up some title issues here real quick.
When you get to the closing, it should be phenomenal. 95% of our transactions are good. Buyers and sellers get along, but sometimes you have to close them in separate conference rooms.
Definitely been there.
Hey, let me throw this out there. 248-539-9797. We'll take your calls all morning long. You listen to the Hardcore Mortgage Real Estate Business Show. Again, 1 hour of some mortgage and real estate talk. And you can call Capital Mortgage Funding all week long at 1-800-LOW-RATE. Get that strong approval letter.
But if you're a realtor, you need somebody to go ahead and peel back those layers. You see it in your end of the industry, before I got interrupted. They have to. Okay, yeah, that's the first dig of the day. There'll be more. Okay, what you need to is you're not just a lister. You don't go in there and say, oh, I can sell your home for $1 million. And they go, oh, $1 million and list it, right? You tell everybody and you set them up for the proper expectations. That's what you do. And that's what good people do. Guess what? Some people might not like hearing it.
No, definitely.
Okay,
not.
They might not.
It gets tricky sometimes. It's a fine line to walk, but, you know, we've always felt that just being honest and upfront.
Love
and
it.
Having the expectations there is key to our business.
Well, great. Good job.
To do it. Because if not, with that transparency, then it's, oh, no, well, you said you could sell it for this, and why are we here? It's 60 days later, and, you know, we're not just going to stick our sign in the ground.
Yeah, those expectations are totally everything. The low-rate environment's definitely giving our buyers some purchase power now. So if the home is priced right and they're out there looking in this marketplace, you guys mentioned a little of the obsolescent homes that are out there. There's something maybe a little different that they're still on the market. They didn't get sold over the summertime, or here we are into coming up on wintertime. So there might be an opportunity where the sellers are still a little bit more motivated than that purchase price. So if you've already had that talk with the seller at 250 and the house is at 275, again, maybe some buyers need to know out there that there is an opportunity to maybe do some negotiation this time of year.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I personally think any time of year there's opportunity. I mean, obviously the longer it's on the market, I mean, that's part of having a professional that's representing you to their fullest, and you know there's always something that can be done in any transaction to make it work. It's just finding that common ground between buyer and seller and kind of having that relationship and professionalism, if you will. But you know, you bring up a very valid point. You know, this time of year there's some people that are gonna be absolutely motivated to sell, and just because it's listed a little higher doesn't mean that you can't get it in your price point. I mean, when we do put up our buyers into our RealCom system and they say, let's say my purchase price is 250, you know, we jump in and say, okay, well, we're going to put it at 275 just because of that negotiation, or if a price comes down or something else, just because we want to make sure everything's open for them.
For whatever reason, the house doesn't sell. Maybe it's got everything going on the location. Everything's great about it, but it's a little outdated. It needs some updating, you know, and families nowadays, the younger generation, they don't have a ton of money to work with. So they're looking for these seller's concessions. And sometimes having that knowledgeable real estate agent that can work in those seller's concessions, like you said, having those tougher conversations with sellers ahead of time and saying, hey, look, we might get you full price for the house, but you might have to kick in a little bit. Seller's concessions. This way it gives you an opportunity to get the house sold, mm-hmm. make it a win-win for everyone in the house, and of course in the transaction.
Well, the one thing I want to say about that is a lot of the buyers, they don't understand when you ask for concessions that you have to look at the net value. So if you're coming in, say it's $100,000 and you're asking for 3% concessions, the sellers are actually viewing your offer as a $97,000 offer.
Right on. Yeah.
Correct. Yep.
All right. So these are the opportunities out there. We always talk about knowledge in the industry. We got knowledge on the buyer side that we're always trying to feed buyers with and make sure that they're prepared for homeownership. But sellers, it's really something that we have to talk about more and more of, making sure the sellers are prepared for it. And of course, sellers become buyers. All right. When we come back, 248-539-9797, all your calls. Good morning. Welcome to the Hardcore Mortgage Real Estate Business Show, brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funding. I'm your host, Harvey Freed. Alongside of me, John Kolb.
What's up, guys? How you doing today? Happy Saturday.
Fantastic, John. Thanks. I like that. Good morning. December 7, 2019, we bring in a special guest from Remax Dream Properties in Northville, none other than Kyle Lang.
What's up, guys? Thanks for having me.
Hey, Kyle. Also, the one of the coaches at Adrian's hockey team.
Yep.
I can throw that out there. We
Absolutely.
Love Adrian's
Why
sports.
Not? A PR.
Everyone at that semester? University plays something, right?
Yes, like it's the whole, everyone on
90%,
campus
90% or something
is an athlete.
Yeah.
I love that. Love that school. I should have gone there maybe. Well, that's okay. I don't know if they wanted
You weren't
me.
An athlete or a scholar. So.
I might have been a little bit of an athlete. But hey, we're going to talk mortgages and real estate, John, because you're definitely a great loan officer. And having Kyle in here, we can talk all about what's going on with the end of the year as we sort of dive into the winter months. Fall is, well, it's just about wrapping up here. We got another week or so. And with that being said, Kyle, it's been busy. September, October, November, really, really busy. What's going on here sort of as we really dip into December?
Yeah, I mean, this last, I'd say 2 weeks, at least for me, has definitely slowed up a little bit. But I'm, you know, we're engaging, talking with clients out there. I actually had a really good conversation with someone yesterday who was, they were complaining like, oh, it's such a seller's market. And I'm like, right now it's not,
no,
you know,
no, it's
like
not, yeah.
There's great deals to be had. I think on the last like three or four buyers we were able to help. We were able to get everything for below list price, and they were able to get some really good equity too as they were, you know, getting started in the process of owning this home. So
I don't know about you, Harvard, or you, Kyle, but what I'm seeing a lot of is short-term purchase agreements and, you know, causing us to have to, you know, jump through hoops to make sure we get this thing done right away. And then we're all ready, we're applied, we're just waiting on the inspection results, and the inspections are failing like crazy, like for stupid stuff, radon, you know, mold in the attic. And it's just, I feel like there's just a new set of buyers out there where they're being very nitpicky and not understanding that, yeah, you do have to put some work into a house before you want to own it outright.
Yeah, we always talk about that. The condition of the property definitely is playing a major factor in it because we have the four seasons here. And all the homes have something going on in them. It doesn't mean an inspection that comes back with a laundry list of things. It doesn't mean it's a bad house, but you can, again, fix the GFI plugs and the smaller things in the house. If there's something wrong with the hot water heater, although it's a major replacement, $750 to about $1,200 for even a hot water heater, these shouldn't be deal killers. How are you coaching these buyers? Because they are first-time home buyers, and the ones that aren't getting all the knowledge up front, it's sort of a process as they're moving along.
Well, there's so many people that they're getting information from, whether it's the internet or the outside world or someone that bought a house 20 years ago, that they don't understand, like, guys, this is still a negotiation, right? Like, I can't tell you the amount of times where I'll show a house that's in rough shape, and a buyer will be like, oh, well, like, you know, it's not worth XYZ. They wouldn't even accept this. I'm like, let's try it. You know, like you have, how many times
what do you have to lose?
We put together purchase agreements, you send them over and thinking, oh, like this isn't going to accept it. And like, yep, they're going to jump on it. You don't know the seller's situation. They could be ready to go. They want to get rid of that house, quickly. They just want to be done with it. I'm working with a seller right now. He's like, listen, as long as they don't come back and say they want $20,000 after this inspection, he's like, I just want to be done. I'm washing my hands of this thing.
Right,
I want to move on. You know,
they want to make a deal.
Yeah, exactly. So let's just work. Let's get together here and let's. Everyone has the same goal in mind. You want to own a house. Seller wants to sell their house.
There's like three types of buyers out there. Well, there's probably a lot more than this, but definitely the entry-level buyer, the first-time buyer, maybe just even the entry-level buyer, then the step-up buyer, and then maybe the luxury buyer out there. But I would say that entry-level pricing, let's say between $100 and $275. Tell me about that inventory right now. What are you seeing? I know you worked in Northville, Plymouth, and those areas.
Yeah, so there's definitely a little bit more now than I would say maybe 6 months ago.
Oh,
like
good.
Stuff's sitting a little bit longer. Well,
that's
just
good
because
know.
It's less competitive. There's less buyers that are out there. Not a lot of people want to work. Or moved.
Brought to you by your Metro Detroit Chevy dealers. Celebrate the season at your Metro Detroit Chevy dealers during Chevy's employee discount for everyone. Hurry in because now's the time to check out the Chevy Silverado. Its bold new design offers industry firsts like a power up-down tailgate and rear in-seat storage. Add in its high-strength rolled steel Durabed, plus class-leading cargo volume and functionality, and you get a lighter, larger pickup that is the strongest, most advanced Silverado ever. Put it in D and see why Chevy drives the Motor City. Visit ChevyDetroit.com.
At the Wine Garden in St. Clair Shores, you'll want to take your time browsing a massive selection of fine wine, craft beer, cigars, and spirits.
Come see me, Vic Tony.
The Wine Garden on Harper South of 9 in St. Clair Shores.
To see contest rules for 97.1 The Ticket contests, go to 97.1theticket.com and click on the contests tab.
97.1 The Ticket and CBS Sports Radio 1270, your homes for the NFL on Westwood One. The New Orleans Saints host the Indianapolis Colts. Monday Night Football, kickoff at 8 after the Juwan Howard Show on CBS Sports Radio 1270.
Alrighty, welcome back to the show. It is the Hardcore Mortgage Real Estate Business Show brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funding. We are powered by Fairway Independent Mortgage Corporation, NMLS 2289. And that's another thing I'm going to throw out
lender.
There.
Yeah. Equal housing lender.
Thank you. Equal housing lender here, yeah.
It just rolls off the tongue, doesn't it?
We brought in, of course, we got some great real estate agents in this morning, Rebecca and Brian Janowak and Remax Define Rochester Hills. I know you guys are down there right off of the Main Street. A lot of fun, great town. It's all lit up. If you haven't gotten down to Rochester,
beautiful down there.
This is the time you definitely check it out. I always stop at Nab's Donuts and pile donuts down my throat and
coffee. Oh, my gosh,
and all
they
that.
Have the best donuts.
I seem like I'm always starving for a donut down there. But we also brought in Justin Bankston, Fidelity National Title. Justin, there always are some titles. Things that pop up when you're involved, it's ugly.
Yeah,
you know. Excuse me. You're good looking, but the situation the situations can get really ugly again nowadays. And for the last about 20 years, surveys here have not been needed for mortgage transactions.
Right. It seems that the title companies and the underwriters of the title agencies have recognized the fact that if there have been several mortgages, that there's been insurance over all of them, all of the property, that you don't need a survey anymore. Now, there's still people that like to get a survey, and there's certainly on bigger parcels of land. There's a stake survey sometimes people want. But, you know, what I'd like to ask you about, let everybody know out there when somebody buys and sells a home that there are really two policies involved. Because people say, well, you know, the seller's paying, you know, for my part of the No. The seller's paying for one part of the policy. Explain the two policies involved in title insurance, okay?
Absolutely. So the owner's policy and mortgage policy is distinct two policies issued in the transaction. The owner's policy is that one-time policy, that the one you referenced paid by the seller. That insures the buyer. It's important that that buyer knows coming in that they're establishing clear title.
It insures the buyer that seller of that property or any previous owners of that property, there are no mechanics liens on there, construction liens, anything like that. And what you're doing is you're insuring over that part of the title.
Correct.
Correct?
Yep.
So if anything comes up, what do? They call you.
Yeah, they call the title insurance company. I always joke around at closing, hey, if your neighbor comes knocking on your door, call me.
Call you. Now, the lender's policy, who do you protect in that situation?
So the mortgage policy is ultimately the lender. The lender always wants a policy without exceptions. So we issue that each and every time in our residential mortgage transactions.
And why do we require that?
Well, you're lending a lot of money to a buyer to buy a house. Mm-hmm. You're securing it against the property. That title is so important to know that it's free and clear, because if your mortgage is jeopardized, you're not going to be able to get your money back.
So it goes the same way. We want to make sure, and you're making sure for us, because you're really representing both parties. You're representing the buyer's interest and the seller's interest. You're representing the lender's interest. And what you're making sure of is that for the lender, there are no previous liens on the property, previous mortgages, any. If it's been discharged, if it has been discharged, what you're saying is, hey, listen, we've checked it out, and we're making sure that the buyer gets free and clear title so they can give it to the lender so you can insure over that part of the title or part of the transaction as well.
Absolutely.
Like it. There you go. Yeah. That was easy. That was title insurance 101.
Well, the thing that you need to understand is that things do pop up. You know, we had a transaction with Justin where it was a for sale by owner, mom, daughter, you know, exchanging keys and all that. And there was some kind of lien from the HOA that was on there from 1996. Well, originally it didn't show up. And then here we are trying to refinance the home that they bought a year ago. And this old HOA policy or lien on title showed up. And all I had to do was call Justin and said, hey, we just got the title in. It looks like this previous transaction is still listed on the mortgage, or I mean on the title policy that should have been discharged. And he said, send me the policy. He looked at it and he said, absolutely right. We got it taken care of. And it's no fault of the title company. It's just sometimes things are not recorded properly down at the county. Or this is an association, a condo, that's now putting a lien on a property for old association dues that no one would have known about, you know, otherwise.
Well, there are all kinds of liens that can pop up, okay? First of all, you just said it. There's HOA dues, all right? Homeowners Association dues. They'll lien your property. If you go through a divorce and your attorney didn't get paid, they'll lien your property. The IRS could lien your property. If you owe a mortgage company, or like in 2001, we went ahead, we did a lot of second mortgages, and we paid people's taxes. Well, guess what? People decided they didn't want to pay us what they owed us. So what did we do? We lien the property. So from time to time, what I'll get, people want to go ahead and sell that house from 18 years ago. Well, in order to sell the house, you have to get clear title. So the title company will call us up and say, hey, guess what? You have a lien on the property. Yes, we do. And in order to sell that property, we have to get paid off. So that's the reason why title insurance is a necessary part of the transaction, and it insures everybody in the transaction. It's something you want as a buyer. You must have it. And you want to know what you're buying that property is free and clear of any encumbrances.
All right. 248-539-9797. Open lines till 10 o'clock. We got sports all day right after that. It is the bowl season. We got the Army-Navy game later. And I think some Detroit Red Wing hockey tonight as they're starting their win streak right now. They've got one. They're up to one right now. So get that going. But we want to talk mortgages and real estate here. And I like the little title talk, and to bring you guys back in the real estate office. A lot of the homes in the subdivisions now have assessments. Our roads have been chewed up. You have the Four Seasons.
Yeah.
Great place to live, but the salt and everything tears up the road. Drive through some of these subdivisions, and it's unbelievable. Looks like bombs have gone off and stuff. So they're starting to repair the roads, but these got these big assessments. Every city's a little different, and those are the things that pop up on title. I think buyers and sellers also have to know what they're assuming. Are they assuming this assessment? Or, like, most purchase agreements are written, and they're usually, most purchase agreements are standard forms. It typically states on there, we see this all the time, Joss, it states that the sellers are going to pay for all special assessments.
We had a situation actually with a condo, and they put an assessment on there for the roads, and the seller couldn't pay the full thing. So in order for our buyer to purchase it, they had to split the cost. He wasn't very happy about it.
Renegotiation 2 weeks into the transaction, exactly. Really, is what it ends up being. Okay, we got tons to share with you. We love that kind of stuff. Get your pre-approval, call Capital Mortgage Funding. Definitely want to talk about that because, Becky, as you know, half of our clients, they're all set. They're ready to go. They've got great credit. They've got great jobs. They've got their funds ready to go. They might even already sold their house, and they're just waiting to find a new property, and they're in that situation. But the other half of our families out there, God bless them. We want to help them all. They've had some problems in the past. They've had some hiccups. They've had some definitely job losses. They don't have their funds together. Mm-hmm. They've had some credit problems, foreclosures, short sales, all that. You need to get in there way ahead of time. Give me a little commentary on that, Beck, what you're seeing in there and how important it is for families to really get in now if you're thinking about buying in the springtime.
The sooner the better. You need to come up with a game plan. We always talk, I'm big on budgeting yourself. If you're a first-time home buyer especially, and you're paying $1,000 for rent and you're trying to buy you know, a $200,000 house, well, your mortgage payment, chances are, is going to be more than $1,000, okay? And that's going to be including your taxes, your insurance, other various items. If you're buying a condo, you're going to have association dues. So we need to have these conversations up front so that way you know exactly what you're getting into and how much. And if you are paying $1,000 and now you're trying to get into a mortgage that's double that, let's just say $2,000, you need to practice that. Take that extra $1,000, put it in a savings account, put that towards your closing costs, your prepaid. So let's just say if you do find a seller that is willing to pay and negotiate some of your closing costs, you still might have to come up with, let's just say, another $5,000. So you don't want to make yourself, you don't want to be married to your house. You want to be able to live at your means or even below your means, but not exceeding those things. So it's very important for us to have the game plan. And that's why it's really important to come up, to have your team. You know, the reason why we work with the vendors that we do, like Rebecca and Brian and Justin, is because it's not because anyone's making money off of each other. It's because we trust them. We're a team of professionals all coming together to make sure that we get you to the finish line as quickly as possible. And one other additional thing I want to comment in is, let's just say you were pre-approved in 6 months, like 6 months ago. Usually a pre-approval is good for 120 days, which is the length of your credit report, okay? If you were pre-approved in 6 months, a lot has changed for you, maybe financially. You need to have an updated pre-approval before you're going back out looking at houses, because we do not want you to fall in love with a house, then we in turn have to update your pre-approval, and then your credit is now not qualifying, and now we're working backwards. It's very important that we constantly stay in contact with you and you stay in contact with us.
All right, that's best practices for home ownership. Be successful at it. Call Capital Mortgage 20, 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage bank. Our music says we're up against a quick little break here. When we come back, we're going to jam-pack it with all sorts of real estate information. We need you buyers and sellers to give us a phone call and a little bit of title talk. 248-539-9797. Show 929. We were talking about concerts between the break. Green Day's coming too, I think, this summer, right?
I think I did see that.
Got Garth Brooks, got Kenny Chesney,
Billy Joel, Alanis Morissette. I saw Bowling for Soup a couple months ago.
There,
oh my
go.
God, such an awesome show.
All right, for all our music fans out there, that's right. We're into music, sports, mortgages, real estate, all that kind of stuff. You've got a tune of the Hardcore Mortgage Show brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funding. Kyle Lang's in from Remax Dream Properties in Northville, which is great. John Kolbsville, here beside me, always doing a great job here. You're part of the show. You're not filling in anymore, John.
I'm a filler.
You're not even a filler anymore.
Like, I'm part of the show now. Four times this year? Come on.
That many? All right. You got to send us more business, Kyle. Do something.
We got one right now that we're working on. Yeah. I think we're closing next week.
Fair enough. Hey, we take your calls, 248-539-9797. Always fun to talk about mortgages and real estate. And when we turn off the mics here for a quick second, we find out what's going on with our personal lives a little bit. Kyle, pretty cool. You were able to go pick up an investment opportunity.
First one, yeah.
You don't mind sharing a little bit with us?
So I've been in real estate now. It'll be starting my fifth year come April, and I've something I've definitely aspired to do. My broker, she's really heavily involved in development, investments, stuff like that, and yeah. So she's been kind of coaching me through it. And one just came across my desk that I thought, all right, let's try to get this done, and bought it. We're in the middle of the process right now. We've had some ups and downs, spent some more money on things that we didn't think would be expensive, spent less on some other things. So definitely a learning curve, but it's been a lot of fun so far.
At the end of the day, so you can we throw some numbers out there?
Yes. Yeah, so I'm thinking. Yeah. So I'm into it for 30. I paid $30,000 for the house.
Okay.
Plan is we'll probably be able to sell for $80,000, but we are redoing it. I mean, everything's going to be really nice. New floors.
It's going to be a great house.
Yeah,
you got to do it the right way. Right?
Exactly.
You're not going to make that quick buck. You're not going to make $50,000 by putting $500 worth of paint on it. You got to do it the right way.
There's
going
to be a lot of flips. Funny story. My brother, he bought a house 2 years ago, and I told him, I said, don't buy this house.
Okay.
Like, it was a flip. It was one of those things where agent owned, and I could totally tell. The agent did all the work. I mean, the paint job was terrible. And I told my brother, I'm like, you don't want to buy this. I had actually showed it to another client a couple months before. Well, what's my brother want to do? He's very defiant.
Right.
You ended up buying the house.
Uh-oh.
And obviously did the inspection, but there's just stuff. There's nothing wrong with the house structurally, but it's just they went cheap on a lot of stuff. And so I said, like, when I do this, when I start doing this, I'm not going to go cheap. I'm going to hire contractors, licensed, bonded, insured people to handle all of my work. And so that's what we've done. Is it costing me a little bit more money? Yeah, probably. But at least I know. And then the person that buys my house is going to have the peace of mind knowing this stuff was done the right way.
And you're proud of what you've done.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, you know, you give a little pride, you know, because people that are out there just flipping and scamming people and getting them the cheap and not fixing, you know, just putting lipstick on it instead of, you know, really putting some effort into it. I wouldn't be able to live with myself like that.
We've had some guys here on the show. I don't want to drop any names, but there's no doubt that they have a reputation now, you know.
Yeah.
Whether it be, I'll just say Kevin on the east side. Kevin, he buys them all over the place. He puts great quality product in there. Not only that, the person who's going to buy your $80,000 or your $100,000, the house that you did, your investment, they don't have a lot of money to fix up the house if something goes wrong on it. Yeah. They need to have a good experience also. You could sell them the house, knowing what you did to the house, show them. Of course, they're going to do their due diligence and get some things done to it. But what a great house. That's a great opportunity for them. They're going to have an $80,000 house that's got a lot of brand new features.
Well, and the way I'm looking at my bottom line is, okay, I could either make $18,000 on this and go cheap, or I could make $15,000 and know that it was handled the right way.
There you go. Hey, let's move off to this call because it's part of our conversation. Hey, Scott, you're an inspector calling in from Imlay City. Good morning, Scott. Welcome to our show.
Hey, is it me?
Hey, that's you.
We got you.
Hey, okay. Yeah, when I was listening to you guys this morning, you were talking about the buyer's agent being coaching the buyers as far as what happens when you get into a house.
All right, welcome back to the show, 9:30. If you're just joining us, the Hardcore Mortgage Real Estate Business Show brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funding. Having some fun in here this morning. Of course, I always got Harry Glanz next to me, Becky Alley, all of us from Capital Mortgage, and these great real estate agents, Brian and Rebecca. Guys out in Rochester Hills, we're talking a lot about Rochester Hills, the fun lights this time of year, all the to get out. You know what? It's dry. This is still home buying season, I say, because it's dry out there and there's a lot of open houses. Mm-hmm. So get out there, get that strong approval letter. If you do find something you're interested in, call us at Capital Mortgage Funding. You'll get hooked up with us. We can generally get a lot of information out to you pretty quickly and get you a strong approval letter and then really start going over all the important stuff. So it's really fun to become a homeowner. We'll talk all about it. Most of us aspire to have homeownership, and there's no doubt that that provides a lot of wealth. The statistics show that people end up generally with a lot better lifestyles when they become homeowners. And of course, that always builds strength in our communities.
It's stability. It's stability for your family. I mean, if you're renting someone's house, they could decide they want to sell it. And then you're out looking for homes every several years, you know, every couple of years. So it's just that American dream that still does exist, that, you know, that ownership, that no one can take that away from you. You're in control of it.
All righty. We're going to definitely want to hear from all you guys this morning. Let's go out to William out there in Hamtramck. I want to thank you for calling in. William, go ahead with your call.
Hey, how you guys doing today?
Real good. What's happening?
Good. I was wondering, my parents own a house and they want to quick deed it to us. And we owe like $60,000. Well, they owe $60,000 on it. And we want to get it. And then eventually in a year or two, we're going to move out of there. So I don't want to like use my first time buyers because I've never bought a house before. And was just wondering, how do you go about doing something like that, quick deeding it or just having them sign it over to us? Or so that's kind of my question.
Okay, well, the quick claim deed would be, do they have a mortgage? You said they owe $60,000, so I'm guessing they have a mortgage that they're paying a lender.
They have a mortgage.
Okay. Yep. Well, that by quick claim deeding it, you become owner of the house, but it doesn't take away their responsibility.
Well, they want to add you on. They don't want to come off of it. They can't
come off
of it. So they're going to add you on there via a quick claim deed. That's an instrument that they're going to put you on the title with. Correct? So that's what they want to do. They want to add you on there. Now, they're still gonna have to make the payment, or
whoever is,
or somebody's gonna have to continue making that payment. So let's just say it sounds like you are. It sounds like you guys are gonna make the payment. You're gonna be on there, and then what? In a year, you want to sell the property, correct?
Correct.
So you can sell the property. It's not a problem.
I can sell the property.
Yeah. Why can't you?
Yeah, you'll be one of the owners.
You're gonna be on there. Now they're gonna have to sign off of it at the closing as well. So whoever's on that title, let's just say, hypothetically, it's your mom, your dad, and you on there. All three signatures must be present at closing.
Yeah, they're going to be on the purchase agreement. Like they're going to be coming to closing.
Right.
Mom, dad, son selling the property. They're going to be, looking at how the funds are going to be distributed, what the tax liability is, all of those different factors rolling into the closing and sale of that home.
Right. I mean, I don't strongly suggest it if you're thinking about flipping the house in the next 12 months. It doesn't cost a lot of money. Just to give me an idea, it's $20?
Yeah, if you were to, the recording fee's $30 in the county, hiring an attorney to do it for you, the low cost, $100 to $150.
Okay, so it doesn't cost a lot of money to add your name to the title to the house. Now your owner's with your parents on the house. You're going to sell it all together. You know, Beck, you know, one of the things you said, William, I love the call, because one of the things he mentioned is this: I don't want to take away my, no, I'm not a first time home buyer anymore.
Right.
You comment on that, because a lot of times there are special programs for first time home buyers, but most of the time it's more of a marketing type of thing.
Correct. I mean, so first time home buyer, there's measure that's a specific first time home buyer, but you either fit in that box or you don't. So let's just say you don't fit in that particular scenario, whether it's credit or you make too much money or you have too much money in the bank, okay? You can still do a 3% down conventional mortgage, not have PMI. You know, we can structure the loan, and there's always FHA. Let's just say the credit is less than perfect. You can do a 3.5% down, and it doesn't matter that if you are on title with your parents on this particular property and you guys sell it as, you know, a family in a year, you can still capitalize on these low down payment programs. You don't necessarily have to be a first-time home buyer in order to capitalize on those things.
Oh, okay. Because, like I said, my parents gave it to us as a wedding gift.
Mm. Oh, okay.
Nice.
That's
so
nice.
I mean, I've been living there for 10 years, and I've been making great all the payments anyways.
Hey, what's that house worth, William? What is that house worth?
Zillow, it was worth like 101.
Okay.
So make sure you want to memorialize that. Go ahead and we can give you, we'll contact you after the show. We'll get you with the proper team so you can go ahead and get that quick claim deed authorized and send it over, and we'll get it recorded for you and we'll take care of it.
Oh, that'd be great. Because I would love to do that, because my mom and us have been trying to figure out how we're going to go about doing this.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll make sure Justin gives you a call after the show and he'll kind of walk you through it, because that's definitely going to be his expertise and something that him and his team are going to draft for you.
Good call, man.
That'll be awesome. Thank you so much. I appreciate it, guys.
All right, thanks for listening. Thanks. We really appreciate it. All right, there's good stuff. 248-539-9797. Justin, no doubt this is where we're headed into some of these title type things that are very, very important for people to be successful with home ownership.
Absolutely.
All right, 248-539-9797. Let's move off to Fred. Fred and Lapeer. Good morning, Fred. What's going on?
I've been living in my home now for 22 years, and I just discovered that some of the area that I've been mowing is actually the neighbor's property.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
I'm sure they're thankful for that.
Yeah, how do you feel about that, Fred? Yeah.
Well, not very good. but if from the area that my house is located on, actually my septic tank and my well is on his property. I just discovered that.
Yeah.
But they said that the guy that took the survey said that he found the original stake, and that's what he was going by. He found that buried underneath the ground. So
okay.
All I know is would I have to go to court on that or what?
So he found the original stakes. Now, are the original stakes on the other side, on your neighbor's property, where your well and septic are, or are they on your side of the property, showing that it's stake surveyed on your behalf?
Well, the stake itself is on, I believe, on my original property. Well, from what he says, it's on my actual property.
Okay.
But that puts my well and my septic tank on his property.
It's on the other side, is what you're saying.
And my house is only like 3 feet from his property line.
Gotcha. Hey, yeah. let's my title guy here. What do you comment on that? Give me some commentary on that.
You know, with something like that, what I'd recommend doing is, you know, you're mentioning the neighbor has told you and the neighbor found the stake. It might be a good idea to start with a new stake survey to verify those property lines so that you could have a good idea where all that's lying.
Yeah, that would be a great call.
Let me ask you this question. How do you get along with your neighbor?
Fairly well. I mean, he's never around. He owns the house next to me, which he rents out.
And the reason why I asked that, if all these years you've been cutting that lawn and the well and that septic's on the other side and everything's good, you know, it's good to know that it's on the other side. But if everybody's amicable and everybody's getting along and they're going to let, you know, I would say for you currently, everything is fine. But in the future, you know, you might have to rectify that. You might have to move everything onto your property. So the only way you're going to be sure is getting a new stake survey. Now, I will say, everybody out there, stake surveys, they're not cheap.
Correct.
Okay, they're not the $90 to $110 survey.
No, they're not the mortgage survey. That's
mortgage
for sure.
All right, don't get confused. A stake survey is where they send somebody out, they send them out with the cameras, they laser it, and they actually put stakes in the ground, and they're doing, you know, and they're measuring it via the legal description of the property. So, and those can be anywhere from, and I'm not a survey guy, so, you know, Mel at Chemtech, don't yell at me. They can be anywhere from $700, $795 to $1,000, $1,100, something like that, maybe $1,200.
Or so, more, or yeah. a little bit more than
yeah.
that, yeah.
Yeah.
But in those situations, I mean, you have that peace of mind. So, when, you know, if he's like, well, my grass is greener than your grass, and now it's on, I'm mowing your grass. And, you know,
hey,
at least
man,
you'll
I keep
just
cutting
know.
It. I yeah. would. I keep cutting it all these well, years. Look, I wouldn't ruffle anybody's feathers here.
Real talk is they might need an easement agreement. We Correct. Might need to get the historic survey. We might need to spend some money here, but maybe make peace with this guy to get everything in order. That way, mm-hmm. if he ends up selling the house, you don't have problems with future neighbors.
Right.
It can get sticky real quick on these type of issues.
Oh, absolutely.
All right, so just do the remedies up front.
Protect find yourself out, now.
All right, find out what's going on there. All right, great call. 248-539-9797. We got a roll of calls going, so we're going to go take one more. We got Carlos calling in from good old city of Detroit. Hey, Carlos, welcome to our show. Go ahead.
Hey, how you doing?
Real Morning. Good, sir. What's so, going on?
I'm new to real estate investing. I purchased a couple homes off an auction, and I just fixed up one of the homes with my own money. I finally got a renter inside of the home. And I want to pull the equity out of that home to reinvest in the other properties and kind of keep growing my real estate portfolio.
Right on, right on.
Do I have to get that appraised? Is the amount of money I can pull out in going to be based on the value of the home? It's going to be based on my credit score? I'm just 100% not sure.
It's going to be all of those things, not to mention the timing of when you bought the property is also going to come into effect. Because if you bought it 30 days ago, then you're only going to be able to access the amount of money that you paid for that property. Okay, but let's just say you've owned this property for 6 months. Well, then at that point, if you bought it for 60 at an auction and the house is going to appraise for 200,000, well, then on an investment property, you can tap into 75% of that equity on a cash out transaction. But in the tune of if you bought it 30 days ago, you put all this money into it, then you're only going to be able to pull out what you put in, which is going to be 60,000, which would have to be documented in that kind of situation. So how long have you owned this property?
I own it for about a year.
Okay. Well, then you're going to be in that situation. So we'll for sure give you a call after the show. We'll talk about it. We'll make sure you get set up.
Alrighty, great Thanks, call, Carlos. Appreciate it. Hey, there's someone dipping their toes into some real estate. Mm-hmm. Great opportunities to make money out there if you want to become a landlord. Why not? Someone else can pay your mortgage for you. All right, when we come back, 248-539-9797, all your calls. It's going to break through soon. I got. What's going on? They said sunny and 39. I don't know. It's coming out today.
Is it a Christmas lights kind of day where you know, these are the type of days where you put your Christmas lights up?
This weekend, nice. Yes, because it's going to be in the 40s, and if you're going to put some lights out, get them out there now. Yeah, might as well.
And they're only out for 2 weeks? Seems like a lot of work.
Well, you can keep them up. Well, after what? January 1st, they come down usually? You don't take them down the day after Christmas.
No.
Do put outside lights up.
I usually do. I have not yet this year.
Okay, well, put something up. Give a little bit, you know. DT,
well, then,
can use
your
money.
If I put them up right now, I'm keeping them till. I'm that guy that's going to keep them until at least January 15th.
Okay, hey, we're good with that. We won't do that show where it's, does your neighbor keep his Christmas lights up all year?
We
had
somebody in our neighborhood that they keep them up pretty much all year. And they
lit, too?
Don't turn them off. Or they just don't turn them on, you know, after the holidays.
That's just
know.
Bad.
Is that bad? That's
that
a bad,
bad
look.
That's bad.
All right, you guys are listening to the Hardcore Mortgage Show, brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funding. We are sponsored by and brought to you by Fairway Independent Mortgage Corporation, NMLS 2289. You can find John and I at Capital Mortgage throughout the week. And, of course, all weekend long, we have people in the office to help you out with that great approval letter. It's all about knowledge in my world.
Who's there right now? Who's there today?
I don't know. I mean, the whole staff.
Ronnie J's got to be there.
Ronnie's
there.
I
feel like his wife doesn't like him.
It's going to be a whole bunch of people.
Kicks
there.
Him out of the house so he comes to work.
All right. But you can give him a call and definitely sit down with real mortgage professionals. You know, there's lots of things that mortgage professionals do. They can do, well, if you sit down with a real one, you'll know right away. Besides going over your credit, that's one of the things that we can do is help get your credit score up. We got the Credit Expert Program. And a lot of times you don't even need to run it through that software program because we can see what's going on with your debts. Having a maxed out credit card or having two or three maxed out credit cards, that's why your credit score is not as high as it needs to be.
Right.
So that alone is something that a lot of families can do. And there is a big difference, John. If you're a 670 borrower versus a 740 and plus borrower, that interest rate does change.
Yeah, I mean, and remember, these credit experts, the credit scenarios that we run everything through, it's not an exact science. So it's credit's very fickle. It's a suggestion on where we can try to get your credit score. And sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But it's better than no knowledge at all. But yeah, Harvey, you're right. You know, sometimes we don't even have to run it through the system because we can see trends and patterns of what people are doing and try to help them and guide them to get them into the best situation.
Another part of course, we always break down your income, looking at your tax returns, the way you're getting paid now, maybe the worst way you got paid even a few months ago. If you change that, if you became a commission employee, that could be a problem for you. It could be a good thing or a bad thing. But you need to sit down with the experts to find out exactly where you're at. I know I'm working with a family right now. They haven't come in yet. The agents are calling me. We're trying to get them in because they are commissioned employees and they run their own businesses. And there's no use of sitting down with mortgage professionals until we can see the documentation.
Yeah, it's planning. So what to write off, what not. Make sure that they're having conversations with their tax advisor to make sure that we can get them show enough income without having to put them in the hurt box with taxes that they have to pay. So just make sure that you talk to the people and it's a team.
There you go. Yeah, they definitely had some people. I talked to someone yesterday. He hasn't filed his taxes in 3 years. So a lot of things are going on out there. You definitely got to find it out. Yeah, that's not a good one. Hey, 248-539-9797. We got Doug calling in from Chesterfield. Good morning, Doug. Welcome to our show.
Hello, gentlemen.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. What's going on?
I bought a condo.
Ticket.
All righty, welcome back to the show, 9:45. I think we got one or two more segments, so come and join the show, 248-539-9797. Always mortgages and real estate. We are brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funding. That's where you can find us all week long at 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker. I know Frank's in the office along with a whole staff, and they want you to give them a phone call because, Harry, this time of year, a lot of our families and friends, they're spending a little bit too much on us. No one's spending anything on me, but the debt can get out of control real quick.
Yeah, Sarah will be mad at you, Harvey, if you don't mention her name, too.
Oh, Sarah's there. All right, Sarah. Yeah. Sarah's in the office,
Ronnie
too.
Ronnie J.
Sarah,
yep.
Frank,
J.
Everybody.
All right, 1-800-LOW-RATE.
Hi, everybody.
There you go. But definitely, debt consolidation is a way out of some really sticky situations. The numbers are just, the savings are always so great. They're actually still my favorite loan to do. That or a purchase could be so rewarding. Mm-hmm. If you're paying high interest rate credit cards, if you're maxed out on them, well, you might have been lucky enough to become a homeowner over the last 5 or 10 years, and you do have some built-in equity. We don't want you to use your house as a piggy bank. You'll never own the thing. But can you potentially not only consolidate debt, but drop the term on your mortgage? You're going to save so much by getting rid of those 5 and 10. You add up $20,000 worth of credit card debt back. Yeah. That's usually $300 to $500 a month. You add $20,000 onto a mortgage, and maybe your payment's another $100.
Yeah, I think what you said, it's a beautiful thing. It is one of my favorite things to do when you're able to call someone up and say, hey, I'm going to take you from a 30-year to a 20-year. We're going to pay off all this debt, and you're saving $1,000 a month. And that's a beautiful thing. But the key that I want to touch on real briefly is, it only makes sense that if we are doing a debt consolidation loan that you turn around and you do not rack up those debts again. Yeah, the point is to kind of give you some breathing room, allow your equity work for you, but do not repeat yesteryear's mistakes and re-rack them up again, because then all those savings just dwindle very fast.
Listen, if you have those 4 credit cards that you've racked up $10,000 apiece on, you got to cut 3 of them up.
Okay.
All right, do yourself a favor. I'm not going to tell you, like, cut all 4 of them up.
No.
I mean, that's unrealistic because you need one. So keep your gas card. Of course, keep your Nordstrom's and keep your MasterCard or Visa. But that's it. I mean, stop it. Because you know what? Do the simple math. The math goes something like this. 4% mortgage debt or 18% credit card debt. Pretty easy to figure out, right? And again, as Harvey said, we use the term all the time. Do not use your house as a piggy bank, but there's toxic debt. And, if you're going to have debt, you might as well make it not toxic.
So, there you go.
And the payment will be lower, shorten the term, as Becky said. Becky's doing a run right now on 20-year fixed-rate mortgages. She's the queen right now of 20-year fixed-rate mortgages.
Oh, hey.
So
I'll sign you up, Harvey.
There you go.
It's been real good.
We got some great calls to get to. But before we go to those calls, Brian, you're a veteran. You served, and I wanted to thank you for that. But more importantly, you brought up the VA loans. They are awesome opportunities for our veterans. The VA funding fee is going to go up a little bit, but the loan amounts are going way up. I believe they're going to be unlimited. We're still looking for clarification. There was a new act that was passed, the Blue Water Act, I believe, of 2019, allowing families to use their VA eligibility with zero down. The funding fee's not that bad, and for our disabled vets, there is no funding fee. Brian, anything you want to throw out there on it? I know I appreciate you serving, obviously.
The VA loan program for veterans is an absolutely fantastic opportunity for the vets to utilize. And, honestly, there's just not a lot of education within the industry, I feel like, of, you know, listing agents and sellers knowing about the process, what it is, who it's for, everything else. And that the misconception is that just because they're using a VA loan, even if they are doing zero down, that they don't have money or they're not qualified. And that's completely false. This is just a benefit that veterans have.
Seller's concessions still allowed up to 4%, I believe, on the VA transaction. Yes. Interest rates on, they offer fixed rates on all 30, 20, 15 years, all those type of terms. Yeah, it's a great opportunity for families definitely to take advantage of that eligibility. Your certificate of eligibility is needed, your DD-214, your honorable discharge papers. Other than that, it's a standard. Put in your information. If you qualify, you definitely could buy a house with zero down.
Yeah, and we'll walk you through that. We're one of the leading VA lenders in the country. Okay.
Yes,
so
we are.
We do a lot, and we give back Wounded Warrior programs. We give away a lot of service dogs. We give away a lot of houses, too.
All right.
Vets. And, you know, I'm pretty partial to that. My son-in-law, he's currently in the Army. He's at Fort Carson right now. He's a first lieutenant, soon to be a captain. So shout out for everybody in the armed services. Thank you very much.
A tank commander, and he runs a fleet. And
the man. It's all good.
All right. Hey, let's roll out to some calls here. And we want to thank everyone who's called in this morning. 248-539-9797. If you still want to sneak one in, let's roll out to Lamar in Detroit. Good morning, Lamar. Welcome to our show. Go ahead, sir.
Hey, good morning. How's everyone?
Real good, Lamar. Good. Thanks for calling.
Good. So I'm in the process of buying a home, and the seller actually signed the purchase agreement. But did they say they didn't notice about the driveway being escrowed into the price of the loan? And now they're trying to say they didn't see it, and they're not answering my realtor. Where do I go from there?
Do you guys want to take that one?
Is it a for sale by owner, or is it listed by another agent?
It's listed by an agent, I believe.
I'm sort of interested on this purchase agreement. Without us really seeing the whole picture, Lamar, you're the buyer, and you made a purchase agreement to purchase a house. Just give us the facts pretty quickly here. What's the purchase price?
$70,000.
You're buying a house, and they agreed to do what?
They agreed to escrow the driveway that need to be done by the city inspection.
Right.
Okay.
Into the price of the home. All I needed was a couple estimates And they did that on the day of my inspection.
But again, we have a signed purchase agreement. You're doing an inspection on the purchase agreement that's signed by all parties. It states on there that they agree to escrow
for repairs on that driveway.
For repairs on the driveway. They're going to sock away. Let's just say they're going to sock away $4,000 that you're going to pour a driveway next spring in 2020.
Or make the repairs because you can't do it now because it's weather related.
Correct.
Correct.
So it was kind of like if upon two estimates, they would agree to pay for that.
Yeah.
Or I'm sorry, it will be escrowed into the price, and then I can go through with my
So for those listening, so what you're saying is that let's just say it was $100,000 for easy math, and let's just say the driveway repair is going to be $4,000. The sellers agreed via contract, what I'm from understanding is that their $4,000 of their proceeds would be held back. So now instead of getting $100,000, they'd be getting $96,000. Correct.
Yep.
And it would be 150% of the actual cost.
Right. That's right. No.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like you said.
Yeah. 1.5 times.
Until next year.
Okay.
Right. So here's the deal. If you have it in writing and you've got the two estimates and you fulfilled your end of that documentation of that agreement, now it goes to the other side. The ball is in their court. Okay. So
they're going to have
to get their realtor involved. Yeah. And the realtor will take care of it. That's what you guys do, right? You'll take care of that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the reality is that all parties have signed it, so now it's a legal binding contract. And if they're being represented by another realtor and you can't get a hold of them, you should talk to your realtor and have them call their broker.
Yeah.
And get the brokers involved, your realtor or their broker, as well as the selling party's broker. And then they're the ones that are going to be able to really kind of dig in for you and get everything and all the information and find out what's going on. Because if there's something where you need to get lawyers involved or anything else, then you know, that's where you need to go.
I see Justin's chomping at the bit right there.
And as a buyer, just make sure you work with your real estate agent. Make sure you perform your side. Get a hold of the title company. Schedule the closing. Part of that performance is making sure that you're showing up and doing your portion of it. So,
Yeah, I like that.
So you fulfill your end.
Absolutely.
You fulfill your end, yes. Go ahead, Lamar.
Just adding, I contacted a lawyer. Even a lawyer told me, just try to get back your home inspection costs if they're hesitant or if you don't really want to go through with this process, because at this point when you're buying a home, you don't want to feel uncomfortable to the point where
I see what you're saying. Yeah.
Sue you or get people involved.
Got it. The attorney says to you, hey, look, if you really don't have the warm and fuzzies about this house, then make them another offer. Make them an offer that says, give me all my funds that I paid. Although I wasted my time, I can't get that back, but I can get my money for my home inspection back. And you'll go find another house. Is that the deal?
Yeah. See what the real reason is on the other end. There's
there you go.
The reason.
Yeah. All right. Hey, thanks for the call, Lamar. It brings up more conversation for us. Thank you. Great stuff. Hey, guys, what I'm noticing, and I've heard it all year long, and you real estate agents know it, you got to get everything in writing and use the addendums. Absolutely. You can just pull up a piece of paper, go to Microsoft Word. I'm no computer expert for sure. And you can call it addendum and list everything. Hey, a separate addendum, non-real estate item should be done on a separate addendum. So when you show up to closing, I was at the gym last week and a guy tells me, oh, yeah, my son was buying that house, every blah, blah, blah. They didn't leave all these appliances that they promised in the basement. They didn't leave the couch and some furniture. I go, well, it wasn't written down. And he goes, nah, you didn't write it down. He was taking the word. You got to have things written down. You got to use those addendums.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. It has to be in writing. All right. Everything has to be in writing.
I can't believe it.
What are we
that
doing?
Was
are
it.
We out?
What? All right.
You guys are throwing us out already?
We're already over?
Come on.
Right. Justin's got so much more here. Hey, let's do our thank yous real quick because we know we got Pat Caputo coming up with sports. Justin Bankston, Fidelity National Title.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Very knowledgeable. Definitely having you back, sir. Really great stuff. And, of course, Brian and Rebecca Janowak, Remax Define, Rochester Hills. Go out there and see them. Stay for dinner. Check out the lights at night. Rochester Hills is a cool place.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having us.
We'll have you guys back for sure. All right. Keep it here for sports all day long. For Becky Ailey, for Harry Glanz, I'm Harvey Freed. We'll see you next Saturday.